Thursday night, right back here. Facts over feelings. We are back in part six of the Nephilim, the pyramid of the apocalypse. If you've been with us thus far, you know we've been breaking down the who, what, where, and why so that you can understand why this is relevant to you. I'm going to jump right back in and have you all join me somewhere in the first book of Enoch with Yahweh's name restored, somewhere around chapter 48, if you have your book with you. I'm going to go off the top of the head, and I need you to keep me honest if I state incorrectly, but somewhere around chapter 48, it confuses the hell out of a lot of y'all who are still worshiping in a slave master's church. You know the slave master's church. It's a religion that they beat into you when you were slaves, and now it's been handed down to your family. It's how they've controlled you, and to this day, they still do. Not saying that God is not real, not saying that none of the things that are reported inside of the Torah are not real. It's just that they've been bastardized and modified so that they can contribute to you not being fully civilized. But somewhere before they tore these books up out of what we call the canon, it says that somewhere around chapter 48, it says furthermore. And when they say furthermore, that means that they've already said something to you, and then they're going to add some more to it to make it more concrete. This is the part that really throws these people, because if you read this, you're going to have some questions. You should have some questions, and your questions should be answered. When you have questions, what should you do? Seek knowledge. That's what it tells you. My people perish for lack of what? Lack of knowledge. Turn to somebody and say, I know that's right. It says, furthermore, in that place, I saw the fountain of righteousness, which does not become depleted, and is surrounded completely by numerous fountains of wisdom. All the thirsty ones drink of the water and become filled with wisdom. And then their dwelling places becomes with the Kodesh, the righteous, and the elect. And pause right there. Somebody asked me, how do I know if I'm one of the elect? How do I know if I'm one of the chosen? How do I know if I'm one of the righteous? And how do I become one? And I let them know, you don't become anything. It was predestined before you were allowed to enter into the earth realm. Your purpose was already decided way before he put you into the flesh container that you in. We all have a purpose, but all of us don't have the same purpose. We all have an ability. We all don't have equal abilities. Some of us have talents that others can't even begin to figure out. And some of us are walking talent and we don't know why and don't know how to use it. Some of us have gifts that we're not using because we're using them for the wrong thing. But the moment that you're tapped into, the moment that you finally figure it out, you'll then begin to understand who you are in the game. The season we're in right now, a lot of y'all are beginning to see signs of who you really are, not who you've been. You see, there's a difference between who you are and who you've been. See, a lot of us are who we are, but we can't be the people that we want to be because our situation dictates that we got to be who we've been. Our situations dictate that we really can't say what's on our mind, because if we do, it could change the whole landscape and that may not be beneficial. So instead of being who we are, we're more like who we've been. Now, when you decide to become who you are, all of a sudden, people don't know how to take you. When you become who you are, all of a sudden, they don't understand where all of this is coming from. When you become who you are, some people will become afraid of you, because in your true form, you're nothing but walking power and truth. And to someone who's not walking in power and truth, you are a threat to them. Remember what I taught about the weakling. The weakling will never ever address anyone who's more powerful than them. They will always try to oppress those that are weaker than them. And when you have a whole race of people who have a mentality that they are better than someone else, they don't want you to speak strong. They don't want you to stand up. They don't want you to start to be who you really are, because it exposes them for being the fakes that they are. And once you expose somebody for being the fake that they are, they gotta make a decision. vision? Are you going to become who you're supposed to be and stop being a fake and walk with the rest of the program? Or are you part of the shit list that needs to go out the door because we can't afford you no more? That goes for every Oreo, every self-hating individual, everybody who done sold out. How you going to sit here and tell me that you love your people, that you down for the cause, but you won't even mate with your people? You won't reproduce with your people. You won't live with your people. You won't invest with your people. You won't build with your people. You won't unite with your people, but you down for the cause. Cause what? Because you ain't got nothing better to do? You a walking country. If hypocrisy was a person, wow. So we get this piece where he says all the thirsty ones, that's those of y'all who want the knowledge to be who you're supposed to be, not who you've been, that you're the ones that they're talking to right now. It says that when that happens, and this is what I'm about to really get into. Here we go again. Y'all hold on. It's about to go this way. It says at that hour, we in 48:3. If you follow, make notes. It says that at that hour, the Son of Man was given a name. Notice he said the Son of Man. And we've already talked about who the sons of men was already. But now we're talking about a specific one. It says at that hour, the Son of Man was given a name in the presence of Yahweh before time, even before the creation of the sun, even before the creation of the moon. Even before the creation of the stars, he was given a name in the presence of Yahweh of hosts. This all happened before any of this happened. This happened before Yeshua walked the earth. This happened before Elijah came. This happened before any of the prophets that you talk about, any of the messengers that you talk about. We already have someone sitting over here that already is being called the Son of Man. And who already had a name, not a title. He already existed. Now, a lot of y'all are confused now. Say, well, he just talking about you. No, I'm not. That's why you got to get your head in these ancient books and see it for yourself. He will become a staff for the righteous ones in order that they may lean on him and not fall. He is the light of the Gentiles, and he will become the hope of those who are sick in their hearts. Let me break y'all off real quick. What he just said to you is that a time is going to come when you're going to be sick and tired of being sick and tired. You're going to be fed up with being lied to. You're going to be done with all of the excuses. You are not going to sit back and let somebody sit there and tell you, just wait on us. We're going to get it straight for you. You're going to get to the point where you don't want to hear it no more. Then someone will come along that will say the right words to make you become who you are, not who you've been. And then everybody gonna lose their damn mind, because when one person starts becoming who they supposed to be and another person start walking like who they supposed to be and everybody starts walking like who they supposed to be, then everybody gonna sit there and say, who set this shit in motion? Because whoever came along, that person is supposed to be a staff. And what is a staff? Staff is somebody, something that you lean on. Staff is something that's gonna prop you up. Something that you ain't got to be strong, because the staff is going to take the weight for you and tell you, do what you're going to do. We got your back. When that happens, when somebody comes along and starts telling you those things, when somebody comes along, listen to this. It says you're going to be a light to the Gentiles. It didn't say you was going to be a light to a certain church. It didn't say you was going to be a light to people who believed a certain way. It didn't say you was going to be a light to the ones who broke a piece of bread and drank some damn juice, but then went out Monday through Friday and did all kind of heinous shit and think they can forget about it on Saturdays and Sundays. It didn't say that. He said in his writing, you're going to be a light of the Gentiles. That means regular folk like me and you. Think about it. Let that flow, because it closes by saying he will become the hope of those who are sick in their hearts. Last time I checked, black folks, worldwide, we are sick and tired of being sick and tired. And the last thing y'all wanted was for anybody to come along and give us a sense of hope. Because once we get a piece of a little bit of hope that maybe we can pull this thing together, we start talking. We start communicating. We start congregating. We start planning. We get organized. We agree on what the main problem is. We put all our problems in the parking lot for 2 seconds to handle this problem right here. Now, I don't know about y'all, and I don't come for accolades, and I don't come for pats on the back. But if there's another person that's come along in 2020 that has inspired our people and given them hope, made them stand up on they with their back straight and saying, we're not taking this shit no more. If I had a gun, I'd go shooting. There's a lot of people who can't get guns. There's people out there right now fighting with whatever they got. But if there's anybody who can say that at least they got out here and tried to light the fuse so that all of us could stand up as a nation that we are, all 12 tribes and even the other ones that want to attach themselves, then I know I'm walking in who I'm supposed to be and not who I've been. And that's exactly what y'all should be doing too.
Can I talk to them for 2 seconds?
It is the essence within the book of the Nephilim and the pyramid of the apocalypse to teach you that very word, conjoined with the book of Enoch, conjoined with the Holy Scriptures, conjoined with the ancient Egyptian text. They're all interconnected. And a lot of y'all been spending all y'all time just on one piece and don't want to see the whole picture. You're not going to get out of this unless you take all of the pieces and put them together to see the bigger picture. Because when you do, it forms a mirror that's been broken. And when you put that mirror back together, you'll see who you really are. You'll see who we really are, and you'll see the enemy for who they really are, and then you won't have any problem sitting around worrying about, oh, we gonna lose all we got. You ain't got none right now. You're gonna get us all killed. You're already getting killed. Don't mess around with them. They will end up on the list. You're already on a list. Y'all don't even realize that the very thing that you seem to be afraid of are already being done to you. This is the pushback. This is the clap back. This is the snap back. This ain't a flashback. This is us coming to take back what's ours. And if you ain't part of that, then step your ass to the side. But don't think that it's just about violence and hatred. It's not. It's about walking in biblical scripture. It's about walking in the words of the Creator. It's not just about talking about it no more. We've been taught enough. We know enough. Now it's time to take what we know and apply it. Goes on to say, it is written, all those who dwell upon the earth shall fall and worship before him, and they shall magnify, and they shall bless, and they shall sing the name of Yahweh of hosts. Now, when you hear that, a lot of people think, well, I ain't bowing down to nothing, and I don't know where they coming with all that. They always talking about somebody bowing down, and y'all don't seem to get it, do you? You're not going to have a choice. Can I talk to some real street folks for a minute? See, I'm the streets. That's why I'm not on CNN and NBC and ABC, because I'm the streets. You see, I speak for the streets. I speak for the brothers and the sisters behind bars. I speak for the people that you can't brainwash with this bullshit. I'm the street. So let me tell you what the streets say, since y'all got it all twisted up in here. When you hear this thing about you're all going to bow down and worship, if the right shit happens, everybody will be on their knees talking about, Lord, please. They talking about that there's a meteor that's supposed to be on its way here right before election day. Yet now they got all these people on TV trying to convince you it ain't nothing to worry about. It's going to be cool. Don't y'all trip. Haven't you seen that lately? They got everybody from Neil deGrasse. If the dude, what was the, remember the dude that was in the wheelchair, the real smart dude that passed away? They'll roll his ass out there if they could to try to convince you that there's nothing to worry about. That's not what the scripture says. Something that happens to make you all fall down, bow down, and ask for some relief. I saw a story today. I don't know if y'all saw it. There are some scientists who believe that the Earth is passing through a mysterious red cloud. This red cloud is making the sky look red in the morning, making the sky look red in the evening, making the sky look red in the middle of the night, making the sky look more red than it should, and it's not coming from the sun. Y'all remember about 2-3 weeks ago, we was all looking at the sky. The sky looked like it was gray, but the sun looked like a dim light bulb. They wanted you to believe that that was because of some fires, but the whole sky looked red. Matter of fact, if you look inside of the ancient Egyptian books, it tells you about the destroyer and how it makes the sky red. If you go and you read, oh, we got 444 attendants up there. I see that. That's nice. But when you go and you research, you begin to find out that the red Kachina and the blue Kachina. Oh, let me say it again. The red Kachina and the blue Kachina. Y'all don't know what that is. Let me help you out. When you see the red Kachina and the blue Kachina, if you see the blue Kachina first, that is an omen of what is coming. But when the red Kachina shows up, that's your ass. Now, that's an old Hopi. The Hopi Native Americans, that is, they say that's an ancient legend. There's no such thing as an ancient legend. There's ancient knowledge that y'all have just forgotten. And I saw a picture somebody sent to me the other day where it was this thunderstorm, and I actually have filmed this myself, where you've been riding down the road and out of nowhere, all of a sudden you look to your right and the sky is this crazy ass red and there's thunderclouds, and then you look to your left and the sky is this crazy ass blue, and you're like, what in the hell is going on? Red Kachina, blue Kachina, signs in the skies. Now it's about to get deep. In 48:6 it says, for this purpose he became the chosen one. He was concealed in the presence of Yahweh prior to the creation and prior to eternity. But he has been revealed. Yes, it says the chosen one. They're not talking about the Messiah. See, that's what they don't teach y'all. The antecedent of time, the chosen one, is not the Messiah. Two totally different beings. When the chosen one shows up, the chosen one is the one who's supposed to inspire hope so that you can walk in your purpose, so that you can complete what this is all about in the beginning, which is what they tried to destroy from the beginning. And when you begin to understand who the Nephilim was, who they are, and who's left around today of that bloodline, it's easy to see who they are. The problem is you don't see who you are. This ain't about them no more. This is about you. And I'm not talking to everybody. I'm talking about you, specifically you, who look in the mirror and wonder, Lord, is this it? I'm trying to figure out what I'm supposed to be doing here. I mean, you know, what are we doing? I'm talking about you. It says then that the chosen one who has been concealed. When they say concealed, they mean that he's been with you the whole time. He's been hanging out with you. You probably went to school with him. Your brother know him. Your sister might hang out with him. We don't know. But he's been here the whole time. At the appointed time, boom, they will be revealed to you. And you will know that it's them by the impact that they have on the entire world. How they can move the masses in a way that is in unison within the message of the Most High. And we don't know who that person is going to be. You won't know until they are revealed to you. But when they are revealed to you, your challenge is not to sit there and deny it. Not to sit there and be stubborn and stiff-necked and say, nah, it can't be, because it doesn't look like what you think it should look like. Didn't nobody take a survey and ask you what you thought it should look like? Nobody sat down and took your opinion of what the end day is supposed to look like. Just because you'd have made up some shit in your mind about how it's supposed to look, and when the whole thing starts to go down, you keep on holding on to what you came up with in your head, and you'll be the last one that gets up there and chill talking about, well, anybody gonna want to hear all that? You have to be attentive and get your ears and your mind open and get your third eye open, because it's written right here. It says, for this purpose he became the chosen one. He was concealed in the presence, and then he will be revealed to the world. And then it says, and he has revealed the wisdom. This is what the chosen one is gonna do. He going to show up and break down for you so that you understand, not with all this mysticism and people trying to use all these complex terms and talk about they studied at this temple and all that shit is fine for them. But how does that help us? It doesn't. And Yah is smarter than that. So he's not going to send you someone who's Kumar Lodge from the Temple of Mysticism on the Rock of Gibraltar from the third. I want to hear all that. Somebody come in here and tell me the truth and feed me the truth so that I can function as a member of these of the nation that I'm supposed to be a member of. I didn't come here to be led. I came here to co-lead. Don't you understand that? If I came here to co-lead, that means that if I fall out, you can still carry the load. That means that if each one is leaning on each other, then we should never have a problem. We shouldn't have to ask for anything because we already have everything that we need. Whether we're trying to finance something, build something, get us somewhere, write something, create something, film something, cut something, grow something, we got everything we need right here. You know, I find it funny, and I got to say this before I go. Those of you all who believe in what I'm gonna keep calling it Slave Master's Church, you believe in the concept of a resurrection. You believe in the concept that your Savior rose from the dead, appeared for a while, then ascended back to heaven. You talk about it all the time. You think that you too are going to be resurrected when something happens to you. But what you skip over and they never talk to you about is that if that is true, then there's no need for you to consistently always be walking around in a state of victimization at a pity party like what you did last week don't count. Because the part that y'all skip over was, yes, even though your particular Savior was crucified, hung from a tree according to the Hebrew word, and placed into the ground, he got up again. Okay, let's say he did get up, but what you fail to realize is when they put him in there, they didn't put nothing else in there with him. That meant that he had everything that he needed to get up out of his situation. They didn't have to send nothing in. Did nobody have to send the offering? They didn't have to move the stone. They didn't have to do nothing. He had everything that he needed inside of there as a demonstration to you that we as a people have everything that we need to get out of our situation. We don't need no help from nobody. We don't need to beg nobody for nothing. We got everything we need in here since we are in this dead state to get ourselves up and resurrect ourselves as a people. That means that in the same way he was dead and alive at the same time, you all are dead and alive at the same time. So we got everything we need right here. We got every skill, we got every dime, we got every attitude, we got every love, we got everything that we need. We even got the children that are the seeds of the new civilization. Somebody say, talk, black man.
It goes on even further to say, and this is the part that I like to jump up and down about. It says, in those days, the kings of the earth and the mighty landowners shall be humiliated on account of the deeds of their hands.
Oh, I'm in the book right now. If y'all not in Enoch 48, I'm somewhere around chapter 48, verse 8. It says, in those days, the kings of the earth and the mighty landowners. See, we don't own shit, so we ain't talking about us. The mighty land, those people who established the continents, redrew all of the boundary lines like they did in Africa and chopped up Africa and made these fake ass countries that are not the true countries that were there like Kush. They don't came up with some other shit. It says that in those days, the kings of the earth and the mighty landowners shall be humiliated on account of the deeds of their hand. What you've done, y'all gonna pay for. Therefore, on the day of their misery, they will not be able to save themselves. And that is lining us up for where we need to land when we talk about the Nephilim and the pyramid of the apocalypse. Because the apocalypse is the place where no one will be saved. The apocalypse is karma on steroids. The apocalypse, no one who has it coming to them will be able to save themselves. You know what's funny about this? You ain't heard nobody sit down and talk to you like this. And I guarantee you, you wouldn't give a dime if you were sitting in church and somebody came out here and preached doom and gloom on your ass. You would sit there and it would scare the hell out of you because you would hope that they're not talking about you. When the truth of the matter is, not only are they talking about you, they talking to you. And they're also telling you the best way for you to survive any of this. But it'll go in one ear and out the other because a lot of y'all are still brainwashed. And though you're listening to this, you can't believe it because now all of a sudden you starting to feel a little stupid. Somebody said that they messing with our broadcast right now. I think that I'm not going to stop it. I'm going to just call it a night. And we're going to pick this up again tomorrow because I'm about to get into the apocalypse. I'm going to thank y'all for hanging out with me on this particular episode of the Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse. Join me tomorrow night as we get into chapter 7, class number 7, and we will go from there. In the meantime and in between time, I'm not going to sit here and play games with the social media. I don't do that. I have talked to you tonight about the Son of Man, the antecedent of time. And next we'll talk about what comes behind that, because then when we get to the apocalypse, we'll then understand everything else that goes along with it. Y'all be sure to join me. In the meantime, y'all have a blessed night. And remember, everything that I'm telling you, don't get mad at me. I'm not the one that actually came here and did any of this. I'm the one that's just telling you what's good for you is good for all of us. And in order for us to rise, that's how we're going to do it. Don't worry. This will be posted on YouTube. Don't let them throw you. I'll see y'all tomorrow. Shalom.